All right, what's up, y'all? Hey, if you have a Bible, go ahead and turn to Mark chapter 5, and we are going to dive into a lot of Bible today. So if you don't have a Bible and you want to grab one, we have a few Bibles on that back table, and yeah, I think there might be more over in the kitchen if you want to grab one. And then, again, if you're on your phone this morning, I'm just going to go ahead and assume that you're on the Bible app. I'm not going to quiz you on it, be like, show me your screen. I'm going to assume you're on the Bible app, and I'm going to hope that that's where you're at, okay? And we're kind of old school in 910. I encourage you to grab a physical Bible. And the only reason for that is it's really hard to get distracted when you're reading the Bible. But if you're anything like me, I can be on the Bible app and I get like a bunch of ESPN notifications and I'm like, wait, who got traded where? And then in the middle of a sermon, like I'll be sitting in big church on my Bible app and then like my notifications are going off and I'm like, sorry, Lair Bear, right? That's what we all call Larry, those of us that love Larry and are intimate with him. Friendship-wise, okay? Intimacy can be a very broad word. Frick, this is being recorded, huh? Okay, y'all, we dove into this story in 910 Plus last night, and if you've ever come to a 910 Plus, it's like one of my favorite things we do in 910. And so let me just, if you've never been to a 910 Plus, let me encourage you, especially if you're a sophomore in here, and you, like, that's not something you regularly do, we're going to start, our leadership team is going to be meeting once a month on Saturday nights. We're going to be doing guys events once a month on Saturday nights, girls events once a month on Saturday nights. So a big part of that is like, hey, come and dive into 910 Plus because we're walking through like chunks of scripture and asking questions like, man, what does this tell us about God? And what does this tell us about us, right? As the human condition. And then where do we see Jesus answering that need, that gap that exists between us and God? And so we processed through actually Mark chapter 5 last night in 910 Plus, but we only got through like the first half of it. And the second half of it is so good. And so we're going to dive into the second half. But a little bit of context for those of you, if you weren't at 910 Plus last night, we see Jesus and his guys intentionally cross over the Sea of Galilee to go to the other side because Jesus is living life on mission, right? Like we just sang, your kingdom is simple and Jesus came to establish his kingdom, right? He's going, I have a mission and I'm living on mission. And so last night we saw Jesus crosses over the lake, and when they're crossing over the lake, this like furious squall happens, right? This storm hits. And these seasoned fishermen who have grown up on the water the entire life, they're terrified. They think they're gonna die. And then Jesus wakes up and he calms the storm. And then when he calms the storm, these seasoned fishermen go from being terrified of the storm to terrified of Jesus, which is interesting, right? Like, I don't think a lot of the times we think of Jesus as somebody that evokes fear. Right? Y'all ever seen like a picture of Jesus where he's like holding a lamb? He's got like the red sash. He's got like a weird glow behind him, right? Or for those of you that went to SCLA last year, the like 20-foot Jesus at Biola, who's got like the red sash and like the blonde flowy hair for some reason. And you're like, wait, what? Like this dude was Israeli. Like that's not how he looked, Biola. And so like when we look at that Jesus, that's not necessarily a Jesus that we go like, oh shoot, like that dude's terrifying. And yet you see the disciples in chapter 4, verse 41, literally say, who is this? Like, who is this guy? At this point, y'all, the disciples have left everything to follow him. And they're still asking the question, who is this guy? And then we see the answer to that, who is this, answered in the very next section. We see Jesus rescue a man who's possessed by a demon. And we see that Jesus enters into this situation. And the demon's goal is to distort and destroy God's creation. And we see Jesus enter in and restore and rescue. And I love this story. And if you have time later this week and you weren't with us last night, I encourage you to just go in and read it. Watch how a demon instantly walks to Jesus, falls on his knees. And some translations, like the New King James literally says, worships him, which is a fascinating concept that the demons immediately recognize who Jesus is. So the disciples go, who is this? And that there's a very real spiritual realm. And within that spiritual realm, you have the enemy of God going, I recognize immediately your authority. And there's no negotiation here, right? This isn't like a power struggle. The demons immediately fall at Jesus' feet, and then they beg Jesus, right? Don't send us out of here. And then Jesus gives them permission. If somebody falls at somebody's feet and begs them, and then permission is granted, there's zero power struggle, right? There's no question about who's in charge here. And Jesus establishes that authority. The demon-possessed man is rescued and restored, and then Jesus sends him out on mission. And then where we're going to pick up this story is in chapter 5, verse 21. And if you're taking notes today, I just want you to write this down, this phrase down, and then we're going to unpack it. Hey, we're about to see two characters, two individuals, who are going to surrender more than they planned to experience more than they hoped for. We're going to see two individuals, two characters in this story, surrender more than they planned to experience more than they hoped for. Okay? So before we dive in, I'm going to read the text here in just a minute, but there's a scene in a show called The Chosen, maybe some of you have watched it, where I love how this gets portrayed in the scene. We were talking about it in 9:10 Plus last night, and then I went and watched it and was like, whoa. It's a powerful visual. So check this out.
It wasn't my piece of clothing that healed you.
But it was instant. I felt it right away.
I know, but it wasn't this. It was your faith. Teacher, she was bleeding so long, we could take her. She is clean. Peace. Your faith has made you well. I wish I could stay here longer. But I have business to attend to. Someone else has faith like yours. But I am so glad that we found each other.
Woo! So good. I love how they both say exhausted at the same time. Did you see that? Did you catch that? It's like they're finishing each other's sandwiches. Okay, here's the one part that I disagree with in that video, right? Like if I was producing The Chosen, we're going to read the text. But remember when he said there's somebody else that has faith like yours? And he looks up and that person, like there's a guy sitting there, his name's Jairus. And he's sitting there and he kind of like smiles with Jesus. I don't think that's how it played out. Here's why, okay? Let's read this, okay? So chapter 5, verse 21. When Jesus again crossed over by boat to the other side of the lake, a large crowd gathered around him while he was by the lake. Then one of the synagogue leaders named Jairus came, and when he saw Jesus, he fell at his feet. He pleaded earnestly with him. My little daughter is dying. Please come put your hands on her so that she will be healed and live. So Jesus went with him. Okay, pause real quick. Look up at me. So Jairus, synagogue leader. In this day and age, if you're a synagogue leader, there's a certain amount of importance that comes with that, right? There's a clout that goes with that. So wherever Jairus goes, one, he has like an entourage. He's got people that work for him. He would have been wealthy. He would have had a household that was managed by many people. And so Jairus, when he comes and falls at Jesus' feet, this is significant. Okay? The fact that a synagogue leader would come to Jesus and recognize Jesus' authority is saying something. And like we live in a day and age where if you go to church and like you're following Jesus, then you're recognizing Jesus' authority. In this day and age, right? Try to rewind 2,000 years, go all the way back to the beginning where Jesus first shows up on the scene, and Jesus is nobody, right? Like he's from Nazareth. He's like his hometown doesn't recognize him. His hometown goes like, wait, isn't this the carpenter's son? Like, what are we talking about? So the fact that a synagogue leader, someone of importance, would fall at Jesus' feet, this is a significant moment. And then secondly, he's desperate. His daughter, which like I try to embody that as much as you possibly can. Like for me, I read this story and it moves me in a whole nother way now that I have a little girl, right? Two little girls. And if my little girl was dying and she was on her deathbed and I was desperate for something to happen, someone to intervene, right? Falling at Jesus's feet, there's a certain amount of like immediacy to the situation, right? Like try to imagine it's your best friend or your sibling or like, who would it be that would create such a desperation for you to go, I have to do something about this? And so Jairus goes and he falls at Jesus' feet and he says, my little girl is dying. Please come with me now. And Jesus goes with him. And this is where we pick up the second part of the story that we just watched. A large crowd followed and pressed around him. And a woman was there who had been subject to bleeding for 12 years. She had suffered a great deal under the care of many doctors and had spent all that she had. Yet instead of getting better, she grew worse. When she heard about Jesus, she came up behind him in a crowd and touched his cloak because she thought, if I just touch his clothes, I will be healed. Okay, pause again. This is, again, a significant cultural moment to understand, right? There's something going on here where this woman has been bleeding for 12 years. And in a Jewish culture, if you're bleeding, you're ceremonially unclean, so, which means, right, she had to walk anywhere she went and be seen as somebody that was like social outcast, reject. She couldn't be around her own family. She couldn't be married, right? There's like so much going on here in this story that like this woman for 12 years, right? Y'all are what, 14, 15, some of you, anybody 16 in here? Okay. So if like for most of your life, for all of your life, except what, 2 years, you have been a complete social outcast. You have been rejected. You have been out, like nobody can be around you. Nobody can touch you. Nobody, like you're just completely isolated and alone. And if you've ever felt isolated and alone, if you're ever wrestling through that, like, would you hear this story and know, like, look at Jesus's response to this moment. Like, put yourself in the shoes of this woman, right before this scene, you see she's even recognized by people around her, and they're like, get out of here. Like, you can't be here. You can't be, like, if she would have rubbed shoulders with somebody, like, if she just brushed by and, like, they touched her, that person would then have to go get ceremonially clean at the temple. So it's, like, the amount of, like, that exists around this woman and the amount of isolation that she would have experienced is bananas. Over 12 years, this woman's been alone. And then we see her see Jesus, leans in, touches Jesus, and she has this faith that she'll be healed. And it says, immediately her bleeding stopped, and she felt that her body was freed from the suffering. At once, Jesus realized the power that had gone out of him, and he turned around in the crowd and asked, who touched my clothes? Which, LOL, right? Right? Even in the scene where we watch it happen, there's like a crowd pressing around Jesus, and then he stops, and he's like, who touched me? And the disciples are like, how do we tell him, like, everybody, right? Like, it's like the world's most crowded place. It's like, for those of you that came to the Padres game on Wednesday, it was like getting on that freaking trolley, right? Like, we're just like sardines in there, just like pressed. And then imagine if somebody in the middle of the trolley was like, who touched me? You're like, literally everyone, right? Like, all of us at the same time, like, we're all pressed around you. But Jesus says this, he goes, no. Because you see the people crowd around you, his disciples said, and yet you can ask who touched me. Jesus kept looking around to see who had done it. Then the woman, knowing what had happened, came and fell at his feet. Okay, notice this already. Right? The first we see Jairus, what's his posture with Jesus? What's he do? He falls at his feet, right? Yeah, he bows. He comes and he falls at his feet and pleads with Jesus. Here we see the bleeding woman come and fall at Jesus' feet. There's an invitation here. When Jesus goes, who touched me? What's the woman? She's kind of at a crossroads, right? Does that make sense? Right? Like, she was just healed, but when Jesus says, who touched me? What does she have to do right now? This is kind of a terrifying moment because she has to stand up in front of a crowd of people that know who she is and say, I ceremonially unclean, like, social reject, made my way into this crowd and touched the rabbi, the one that's like everybody is here to see. Like, this is a heavy moment. And Jesus goes, who touched me? And I want you to see the significance in Jesus' question here. There's an invitation here. Does Jesus know who touched him? Yeah, right? This is like Genesis chapter 3, where sin first enters into the picture and God goes, where are you? To Adam and Eve. Did God lose Adam and Eve? No, right? An all-knowing, all-powerful, sovereign God wasn't like, right? Like, that didn't happen. And so Jesus goes, who touched me? And he's not asking here who touched me. There's an invitation, and this woman has to decide, do I press back and run away? And do I continue this life of shame and cycling and, right? Like, even though she's healed, like, she's might be physically healed, but there's still not this, like, restoration of who she is. And so Jesus says, who touched me? And there's this moment of invitation here. And she came and she fell at his feet in verse 33. Trembling with fear, she told him the whole truth. And I think this is significant to see her response to Jesus' invitation. And he said to her, daughter, circle that word, your faith has healed you. Go in peace and be freed from your suffering. Okay? This word daughter, and you see it, it was so powerful to watch it in that video because for 12 years, no one has called her friend. No one has given her like a physical touch. No one has come near her. No one has entered into relationally with her. And Jesus stoops down, looks her in the eyes and says, daughter. And you saw the emotional response, right? And like I realized this is like a visualization of this. But when you catch the significance of Jesus leaning down and saying, daughter, this is massive, right? He's restoring and he's saying it loud enough for the people around him to hear. Does that make sense? So he, like, basically Jesus is saying, like, this woman is mine. She's my daughter. If you have a problem with her, you got to come through me. Like, this is like a powerful Jesus moment where he looks her in the eyes and goes, daughter. And everybody else goes, huh? Like, she's mine. She's with me. She, right, like, daughter. And I think this is so significant because this woman has been, like, on the outcast. She's been on the fringe for all of these years. And then Jesus, the one that they're all there to see, is the one that recognizes her, looks her in the eyes, and calls her daughter. Right? This is like the most powerful invitation that Jesus has for this woman, but also has for you and I. Right? Like if you've ever felt like this social outcast, reject, right? Or if you've like the moments that you felt alone or isolated, like this is the heart of Jesus that is leaning in, inviting, going, daughter. Romans chapter 8 makes it crystal clear that when you and I surrender our life to Jesus, walk in step with him, that we become son or daughter of the King of the universe. And some of you have like a really good analogy of a dad or that could look at you and call you daughter, and it's like significant. Like you feel valued by your dad, you feel cared for by your dad, right? You can look up to him as an example of somebody that you go like, that is what love looks like. And some of you have a horrible example of that. This woman had lived for 12 years with zero intimacy, with zero love, with zero acceptance. And Jesus's invitation to say daughter is the same invitation that he extends to you and to I, right? For those of you that you might feel like, right, I don't have that dad. I don't have that person, right? No one has made me feel that valued. Would you know and understand that there's a God that looks at you and goes, daughter, mine, right? Son, mine. There's an invitation there, and this woman responds to that invitation. But I love going back to that beginning statement. These are two characters. They're asked to surrender more than they planned, to experience more than they hoped for. How much did this woman have to surrender? A whole lot, right? How much risk did she have to take on? A whole lot. How much belief did she have to have? A whole lot. Right? Now we're going to look at the second character, and this is where I disagree with the video, right? Verse 35, while Jesus was still speaking, some people came from the house of Jairus, the synagogue leader, and said, your daughter is dead. Why bother the teacher anymore? Hey, pause. Jairus comes, falls at Jesus' feet, and begs him, my daughter's dying, right? There's a desperation in Jairus, yes? Right? Like, if your daughter is on her deathbed, and you've gone to every doctor, you've done everything you can, you're a powerful man, and you're desperate enough to go and find a rabbi that you've heard rumors about, right? And he falls at this rabbi's feet and says, my daughter's dying, come with me right now. And Jesus is like, all right, I'm coming with you. Like, there's a moment here where it's not, it's like, Jesus, can we run? Like, can we move a little bit faster? Can we get on a horse? Like, what can we do to expedite you moving from where we are right now to my daughter because she's on her deathbed? And then all of a sudden, a woman, right, who's ceremonially unclean, who Jesus has no business spending time with, interrupts you moving from your moment of desperation to get to your daughter. If you're Jairus, what are you feeling right now? You ever been late for something before? When you're late, does it feel like you hit every red light in the car? Right? If you're early, and if you're like, whatever, like I got time to spare, like a red light hits and you're like unbothered by it, unfazed, right? How many of you live off the 76 or have traveled on the 76 before? If you've ever been late, the 76 is literally torture. Right? Like if you're late to something and you're trying to go on the 76, it's like, right? Like it just feels like every red light is like, like it's maddening. I live in Fallbrook. And so if I'm ever late to church, the 76 feels like absolute hell. It's like, this is the worst thing ever because you just hit every single red light. So Jairus is already feeling desperate. And then all of a sudden this woman interrupts Jesus and Jairus is like, really? Like, my daughter, little girl, is dying. This woman's been bleeding for 12 years. Like, can we come back? Like, can we go to my daughter first and then you come? Because, like, she's been having this issue for a long time. Homegirl's going to keep having the issue. Like, can we come back to this because I'm desperate? And then what? His desperation goes from bad to worse when somebody comes and finds him and says, what? Your daughter's dead. Don't waste the teacher's time anymore. Overhearing this, verse 36, Jesus tells him, don't be afraid, just believe. Okay, so this is invitation number two. The first invitation we saw was Jesus saying, who touched me? And then we saw the woman's response. The second one is this, right? The second one is Jesus saying, don't be afraid, just what? Just believe. Don't be afraid, just believe. Now, so the woman found herself at a crossroads, having to make a decision. What do I do with this? Here we see Jairus at a crossroads, asking, what do I do with this? Do I choose to believe Jesus? Or do I just go, she's already dead. What do you mean believe? What do you mean, don't be afraid? My worst fears have just been realized. As a parent, I promise you, the worst possible fear a parent has is that losing a child. And his worst fear was just realized, and he finds himself at a crossroads going, what do I do with this? And if you find yourself in a moment where you're like, this is my worst nightmare, I can't imagine this happening, know and understand that God's not just like some God pie in the sky, ethereal being that's going like, deal with it. Right here we see an example of Jesus entering into somebody's worst day, going, don't be afraid, just believe. And here Jairus has to make a decision. Jairus has to go, do I continue to believe the same faith that brought me to fall at his feet, or do I go, it's over? God, I knew you didn't care about my situation. God, I asked you for help and you didn't help me and my daughter died. What is wrong with you? Jairus has every right. Like if Jairus rejected Jesus right now and walked away, we would all kind of go, makes sense. You fell at Jesus' feet and you said, asked for help and Jesus is like, I got you. And then his daughter died and you're like, Jesus, what the heck? I thought you said you were going to help. And he says, don't be afraid, just believe. Verse 37, he did not let anyone follow him except Peter, James, and John, the brothers of James. When they came to the home of the synagogue leader, Jesus saw a commotion with people crying and wailing loudly. He went in and said to them, why all the commotion and the wailing? The child is not dead, but asleep. But they laughed at him. After he put them all out, he took the child's father and mother, and his disciples were with him. And he went in where the child was. He took her by the hand, and he said to her, Talitha kum, which means little girl, I say to you, get up. Immediately the girl stood up and began to walk around. She was 12 years old. At this time, they were completely astonished. He gave strict orders not to let anyone know about this and told them to give her something to eat. I love that Jesus enters into this moment, right? And not only physically restores, right? But he cares not just about her physical life, but he cares about the same thing that he cared about for the bleeding woman. Right, Jesus could have just, right? Like, does this make sense? Jesus could have just let the bleeding woman get healed and then let her go on her way and kind of give her like a wink, right? Like as she leaves, Jesus is like, I know what happened. But what does he choose to do? He stops and makes a spectacle of it. Do you understand that? Do you understand what that did for that woman? Everybody knows who this woman is. Jesus stops in the middle of a crowd and goes, who touched me? And everybody's like, this is awkward. And then he finds the woman and in front of everybody makes a declaration, daughter. This is a very public spectacle. And then with the little girl, the 12-year-old, right, he heals her and then says what? Don't tell anybody. Isn't this interesting? Right, two different situations, two different responses from Jesus. One, he makes a very public spectacle. Two, he keeps very private. I don't know about you, but if you're like an evangelist, like a traveling evangelist, and there's already a crowd around you, and you want an even bigger crowd, do you know what sells tickets to an evangelist show? I'm the guy that raises people from the dead, right? Like, I'm the guy that takes little 12-year-old girls who were dead. There were witnesses, right? Do you remember what happens when Jesus says, she's not dead, she's sleeping? What did they do? They laughed, which means there was a whole crowd of people that knew she was dead. And Jesus doesn't take this show on the road and go like, look at me, I'm Jesus. No, he goes, hey, let's keep this quiet. Why? Because in the same way that the Jesus didn't just care about the bleeding woman's physical health, he cares about restoring who she is, her identity. And in the same way, Jesus enters into the 12-year-old girl and goes, I'm not just gonna care about your physical health. I'm not just gonna physically raise you back from the dead. I care about who you are. I care about restoring you. I love the way Chris Brown always says, like, nobody wants to take zombie girl to prom. Right? I love that quote of just going like, yeah, imagine if homegirl Wake like grows up and she goes to high school and everybody's like, yo, isn't that the dead girl? Like, isn't that the girl that was dead now? Like, that's kind of spooky, right? And if that becomes like your identity in town, you're like, oh my gosh. Right? In the same way that the bleeding woman was a complete reject, if this becomes who she is as she walks through the streets, everybody's like, ooh, like she was dead. She experienced the other side. Jesus goes, don't tell anyone. But two places here, we see the bleeding woman have to make a choice. And then we see Jairus have to make a choice. Surrender more than you ever expected to surrender, to receive more than you ever expected to receive. What was the healing woman after? Or what was the bleeding woman after? What did she want from Jesus? Physical healing. What did she get instead? Restored identity. Invited into relationship. Right? What was Jairus after? Heal my daughter. Did he get that? Absolutely. But he got even more than that. Right? He himself had a moment where he had to choose to believe or not to believe. And I love the word in here where it says, your faith has healed you from the bleeding woman. And then the word for don't be afraid, just believe. It's actually the same original word in the text. And this word is, it's this word for faith and belief. It's called pisteo in the Greek. But here's what biblical faith means. And this is just how I'm going to end. Biblical faith is this. It's to believe, number one, to trust, number two, and to act, number three. Biblical faith believes, biblical faith trusts, and biblical faith acts. Now, why is this important? Because it's easy, right? If you're sitting here on a Sunday morning, right, my assumption is you or someone in your family, like maybe your parents force you to be here, but like there's some sort of pursuit of like, we believe that there is a God and we believe that he's important, that we believe that he has some sort of impact on this world. Okay, but the story right before this, you remember Jesus crosses the Sea of Galilee and the demon-possessed man comes and falls at Jesus' feet. The demons recognize that there's a God. So you look at this and you go, okay, I don't think anybody in here, if I asked for like a raise of hands, I said like, hey, how many of us want to have demon faith? None of us are like, ooh, pick me, right? Like that's not necessarily like the thing that we want to identify as. And yet a lot of us in here, if I asked you like, hey, do you know Jesus? Or are you a Christian? Like maybe your answer would be yes. And if I said, why? You go, well, I believe that there's a God. And there's a little bit of it in here where we go like, cool, so did the demons. In fact, not only did they believe that there's a God, they fell at that God's feet and recognized his authority. When was the last time any of us came into worship and understood and recognized the authority of God and the God that we are entering into his presence? If you're anything like me, it's kind of easy to just like check my phone during worship and kind of maybe be distracted a little bit and go like, eh, it's just church, it's just a Sunday morning. It is what it is. And so if you're sitting in here and you go like, no, sure, I believe that there's a God, friends, that doesn't mean that you have a relationship with Jesus, number one, and it doesn't mean that you're saved, number two. And I don't say that to be like mean or harsh. I say it because this is what the Bible describes to us as what faith requires of us. And it's not just recognition, belief that there is a God. What we see in the bleeding woman, what we see in Jairus, is a belief that then trusts. And that trust moves them to act. When Jesus said, who touched me? The woman could have easily just backed up into the crowd and disappeared. When Jesus said, don't be afraid, just believe, Jairus could have easily been like, you failed me, Jesus. I asked for something and you didn't come through. Right? Jesus's timing was perfect in this. God never makes us wait needlessly. That's not God's heart. God isn't just sitting up in heaven going like, we'll see how they handle this one. No, God never makes us wait needlessly. And Jesus says, don't believe or don't fear, just believe. But that belief, friends, again, isn't just a cognitive belief. What did it require of Jairus? Trust. And then what did that trust cause him to do? Act. So I'll just give you the lens to look through, right? And I'm just going to pray for us here in a second. But this week, I would maybe even just challenge you. If you come to 910 regularly, or if you believe that there is a God, or you would open up your Bible and go like, no, I do desire a relationship with Jesus. Let me just ask you that question. Right? Does your faith, does your belief move you to trust? And then does that trust move you to act? Or is God just like some category in your life that you go like, no, I live most of my life. I do my like San Diego high school student thing. And then like there's a God column in my life that I go like, no, sure, there's a God. But recognizing that there is a God, that kind of puts us in line with the demons. We're like, cool, you recognize there's a God. What does that recognition lead you to do? Does it lead to a trust? Does it lead to action? Now pray with me. God, thanks for this weekend. Thanks for the opportunity, Lord, to just open up your word. God, to read a story about two characters who are probably both in a really desperate spot. And God, I just pray over these students, even over us as leaders. God, you know what's going on in our lives. And maybe some of us in here are stoked. Maybe we're loving summer and we're in a really good spot. But maybe some of us are struggling in here. And God, for the students or maybe the leaders in here that are in a rough spot, that are struggling, that are wrestling, God, would we hear this story as an encouragement that you loved us enough to send Jesus, and Jesus demonstrates over and over and over and over again a willingness to enter into that struggle. And then in the middle of that entering in, there's an invitation to believe, an invitation to trust, and an invitation to act. God, would our response this week not just be a mental recognition that there is a God, but a movement, a transformation, an acceptance of that invitation? God, we love you. Thanks for loving us first. In your name we pray.